Welcome, everybody, to Paper Prototyping with the Indie Game Academy, hosted via Work With Indies. This is the second one that we're running with Work With Indies, but actually the fourth time we're running this workshop. We're very excited for today. I am obviously talking to nobody right now. This is for the sake of the recording that you'll be able to look at later. We're just about time to start making sure things look good before I start letting people in. So far we've got 7 waiting, which is great. Let me make sure everything is fine. All right, I think we got everything we need. Okay, let's let them in. Welcome, Eric. Welcome, George. Welcome, everybody. Hello, Jordan, Jim, PC, and Corey. How's it going?
Good.
It's good.
Yeah. Very good. Amazing. Corey, I like the little dragon you got on your profile picture there. It's cool. All right, letting people in bit by bit. So to make sure everybody knows, this is the Paper Prototyping Workshop put on by Work With Indies, hosted by the Indie Game Academy. So if you're in the wrong place, speak now or forever hold your peace. We're gonna get started in just a second. We usually wait 1 or 2 extra minutes because people are slow. A couple of rules. Number one, I actually love to see your faces if you're willing to turn on your cameras. It helps me teach. I can, you know, connect with you a little bit. That's always good. And then also I can tell if somebody is thoroughly confused and they need to stop and talk about stuff. So if you're comfortable, hello, it's good to see you, Paul. If you're comfortable, turn on your cameras. But second, with that, keep yourselves muted unless you're currently talking. This is generally a very sort of, open workshop. We tend to talk a lot. We tend to have a good time together. So you're very welcome to talk, but just we don't want to hear your dog barking in the background. So unless you are currently talking, please keep yourself muted. And then lastly, and possibly most important, let's try to keep this a fun, encouraging, kind space. We want to see the game industry turn into that. So let's do that right here first. All right, Surya is coming in. We're going to get started in just 1 or 2 minutes. Who has paper prototyped before? Not ish. Do we have anyone? If you don't have your camera on, you can also type in the chat. I'm always watching that. And you can use the little reactions like that. So it doesn't look like anyone has paper prototype. Who has game development experience? I'm assuming a good number of you. Okay. Anybody released a game so far? Published a game? Jim, what did you publish? You willing to share?
Yeah, sure. I made a game most recently called Wonderland on the iOS App Store, and it's okay. Audio drama.
Okay.
Where you have to solve a puzzle at the end of each chapter, and if you can't solve the puzzle, then you go for a walk, and every 100 meters or so gives you a one-letter clue.
That's kind of awesome. Is the intention to like encourage people to take deep breaths and be mindful about their problem solving?
Yeah, and just I love walking, so I want to push it on more people.
That's great. Put our ideologies on others. No, I'm just kidding. That's wonderful. I love seeing video games used for good stuff. I will start to get started. Paul is a graphic designer / illustrator from another industry. No games industry work so far. Fantastic, Paul. Are you trying to break into the industry? That's my favorite kind of people. I'll let you leave responses.
Yeah. Oh. I'm yeah, late, bit late in the day at 52, but I've got some game ideas. So
heck yes. Well, that's why we're here today. Fantastic. Okay, so I'm going to jump into the presentation in just a moment. First of all, an introduction so that you know who you are listening to and that I know what I'm talking about. My name is Willem Delventhal. I'm the headmaster of the Indie Game Academy, and I've been working in the game industry for 12 or 14 years now. I got sort of accidentally started way back in the day when I half accidentally sold a game to addictinggames.com. Does anyone remember that? The classic days of Flash gaming, rest in peace, Flash. And that made me realize that, oh, I could actually make money doing games. I broke into the industry after school. My first professional job was at Lumosity, if you guys know them, the brain training game people. I first worked for an internal startup for them where I was doing educational games for 2 to 6 year olds. That's where a ton of my game development experience, some of what we're talking about today, comes way back from that. After doing that, moved into the main team for a couple of years, started a couple of different companies, including the Indie Game Academy. And now I'm a senior game designer at Together Labs, where I'm working on a metaverse, basically to bring people closer together, to make a safe space, particularly for teens who are underserved. So I have a lot of game development experience, and there are a lot of tools that I run into. I also work with a lot of people who are fresh to the industry. So I get a good perspective on what people know, what they don't know, what's unfamiliar, what's new. And one of the things that I find is that people are unsure, or perhaps not unsure. People don't have an established process of actually choosing their games. Most people are like Paul here, who are like, I got all these ideas. How many people have at least one game idea? At least one. How many people have more than one game idea? Yes, all of us. So what we're going to talk about today is a couple of different practices, not just paper prototyping, that help us choose a concept that is going to be more likely to succeed. And I use air quotes because success can be so many different things. If it's a personal project, success is just like something that I'm going to enjoy working on, or something that I'll learn from, or that'll be a good portfolio piece, that kind of thing. If I'm running my own indie studio, it's one of the things we love to try to help people do, for instance, then I have to care about something that I actually think will have market traction. And as I get bigger into the AAA titles, then of course, that's really all I'm focused on. So I'll say this for the last time, and then I will open up the presentation and we shall begin. Everybody here, you are welcome to turn on your camera. It makes this a much more enjoyable experience and it helps me teach. I can tell if people are confused or have questions, et cetera. Please keep yourselves muted unless you are currently talking. You are welcome to jump in at any moment. You know, let's not interrupt each other. Please don't interrupt me, but you're, you know, if there's a pause, feel free to unmute and say like, hey, well, what about this? Ask questions, et cetera. If you are uncomfortable with that or don't have a mic or whatever, feel free to use the chat as well. I do my best to watch that as we go. Let us begin. All right. So welcome everybody to Paper Prototyping. This is a class I've taught a couple of times at the Indie Game Academy in our larger 3-month boot camp. And it's one of the ones that people love every time we do it. And so a couple of months ago, we decided to experiment and do it, you know, as its own dedicated workshop. It went really well. Here we are doing it again. So this is the fourth time we've run this with an outside audience. Really excited to be doing this with all of you today. So paper prototyping and you. It sounds like many of you have not paper prototyped before. It is such a simple, powerful tool. It really just means prototype your games without code. Actually, does anybody know what a paper prototype is? Can we describe what a paper prototype is to the room? Anybody want to take a stab? Be brave. I believe in you.
I can try.
Go for it.
But yeah, it's like you said, it's basically just prototyping the game without having to code anything at all.
Yeah.
Like, for example, like a mobile app, right? You can make cutouts, mm-hmm. Drawings and stuff. Basically, yep. You make the game functional through the paper.
Yes.
So that you can translate that over to like coders.
Yes, exactly. Yeah. So it's sort of interesting. It's definitely a bit of a murky definition because I think there can be a lot of things that are considered a paper prototype. For instance, while most of our paper prototypes, I'll show you an example today that I created for this event. It's a cute little dungeon crawler, are actually on paper. Especially in today's day and age where we have COVID, et cetera, I frequently paper prototype online. So I'll have something like this where it's just like a really quick mock-up. There's no actual code. I am actually manually changing these values, you know, for the people who are playing the game as we go. This is what I would call a digital paper prototype. But the distinction here, in my mind, is that a paper prototype is simply a prototype, something that allows us to test a game or a specific element of a game without having to code anything, without having to put any code into any system. So a paper prototype can be pretty loose. Most of the time it means we've got like dice and pieces of paper we've cut out and we're actually gonna play a game on the table. But sometimes it means something more like this. Here's a little puzzle game where you mix squares together. Also, I just want to call out, watch the chat, guys, because there's good conversation going in there. Jim says that he got his first industry job at 48, Paul. So you're doing great. You'll be fine. All right. So this is put on in conjunction with Work With Indies. So thank you, Work With Indies. We love them so much. We've done a ton of different workshops with them. Thank you guys for coming and hanging out with us today. The Indie Game Academy is a gamified video game bootcamp. You can basically imagine we're online Hogwarts. We make crazy, silly, goofy, fun schools and workshops and classes. And we can talk about that a little bit later. But the sake of today is to talk about paper prototyping. So first, we're going to cover exactly what a paper prototype actually is and why we prototype in the first place. Then we're going to show you some examples. Then we are going to run through a brainstorming process that I really like and what's called a filter list so that you can choose what game you are going to make yourselves. Then we'll give you some time to actually make a paper prototype together. I'll be coming around and checking on you. We'll answer questions, and then we'll finish by actually doing some play testing. So you will all play your games live tonight or today with at least one other person. So here is the age-old conundrum. I already asked this, but I'll say it again. How many people have at least 5 games that they would like to make? Ooh, not that many? I don't believe you. At least 5? We don't have 5 games you might want to make. Yes, yes. I definitely have more than that. One thing to take away, very, very simple one. As you come up with game concepts, record them somewhere. Such a simple practice, but you never know. I've had game ideas that I came up with 5 years ago that I wound up building. That is actually true. I released a little mobile game recently where the idea was 5 years old. So keep coming up with concepts and put them somewhere. But coming up with concepts introduces this problem. How do we actually choose a game? And in the industry, it's even worse because our money is on the line and our jobs are on the line for when we're actually choosing concepts. This is John Nelson Rose. He's an associate technical director at EA. He's also the founder of his own indie studio called Opium Play. He's was a mentor of mine way back in the day, and he has done a lot of teaching with the Indie Game Academy. So he often teaches a class on prototyping in general and why we prototype. So what I'm going to show you is from him in these next couple of slides. So his sort of explanation of why we prototype at all, why we bother doing that instead of just picking a game. Because that's how a fresh person in the industry usually works. They go, ooh, I have this new shiny idea, and now I'm going to work on it for like a year. And then they're sad that it took them a year to actually finish it and release it and that no one wants it. Instead, he suggests that you prototype before ever choosing a concept, basically to minimize risk. We can theoretically build anything. I ran into this shaman type dude down in Mexico a couple months ago. And I told him I was a game developer, and he said, ah, you create new worlds. And I was, first of all, that's amazing. I'm never going to stop saying that. But second of all, it's true. We can fill our game development sphere with basically anything. We can make, for the most part, any concept we can come up with. And so that decision paralysis, actually choosing a concept, can be very challenging and very expensive if we get it wrong. So prototyping is simply a way for us to reduce risk. How do we choose the best possible concept, whatever our situation may be? Even if it's just a personal project, how do we choose the best personal project to invest your life into? Months, years of your life into. The rapid prototyping steps, as John describes them, are here. We're going to do a couple of them today. So one, we define the main problem and state constraints. We will do that. Then you'll do some research. That's something I always recommend. If you have an idea, if you're like, oh man, this match 3 game would be so cool if it had zombies in it, go play some match 3 games, find some other games that are similar, do your research before you ever even prototype. That can really help. It can really help answer some of the fundamental questions. Then actually do some brainstorming, which we will do today, some ideation. Then identify winners, which we will do today. And then build and play test your games before actually choosing one. So let's talk about what a paper prototype actually is. Here, before I give... And we've talked about it enough. So a paper prototype is simply a test meant to reveal something about a game. It is typically used to prove or disprove a single hypothesis. So in the industry, when you are using paper prototyping, much of the time, it's not to test an entire concept. It's to test if the new menu layout is going to work well, is going to be easy to understand. What's up, Nelson? It's to test if the new boss is as dramatic as you think it's going to be. It's to test if people can understand the tutorial, if the tutorial is clear. Most of the time when you sit down to do a playtest, it's not, is this game concept good? It's, is this little part that we're thinking about changing good? So today we're going to use our paper prototypes simply to test a game concept. We're going to say, is this concept fun? And that'll be our hypothesis. I think this could be a fun concept. But I just encourage you to use it for more than just that. Use it for many different things. Test different parts of your game before you have to invest the time to actually coding anything. The tester acts as the game engine, and it's mostly meant to allow rapid iteration. So this is, it's actually not in English, so I'm not sure exactly what's going on, but this is a perfect example of a live action paper prototype. These are a group of high school students. One of them created this game, and you can see that they're all playing this game together. Paper prototypes get used way more often in the tabletop game design space than in any other game development space. And that's because it's really easy for the most part to paper prototype board games. But there are, you can use paper prototypes for pretty much anything. Definitely there's some games that are gonna be hard if you're gonna make a first person shooter. I don't know if a paper prototype is gonna be very valuable, but you can see that this is a live action puzzle game, a platformer, and they still have a pretty impressive looking paper prototype and are able to play their game with real users to see what these people think of this concept before having to invest any real time into it. So that is a live paper prototype. All right. Letting some new people in, some stragglers. So the pros of doing this thing, the pros of putting together actual paper prototypes and testing those with people. Number one, it's fast as heck. Super easy to test your game concepts. Number two, it's cheap to put together. So in the industry, one of the first things I was doing at Lumi Kids, for instance, when I was creating educational games for children, I was one of the designated people to create digital prototypes, to actually create a functional computer game that was simplified, but still fundamentally functional for our testers, for these kids. So we would spend anywhere between 3 days and a week on each of these prototypes, and we did 6 to 8 of them before we actually chose a game. So that's multiple weeks, it's a month or more of my time, which as an engineer, is pretty expensive to a company. And even if it's just you, your time is valuable in order to digitally test these game concepts. So paper prototyping is meant to eliminate that waste of time as much as possible anyway. It requires that you simplify your core loop, which is actually sometimes really valuable. I have a really interesting example when we come time to create some games of a game that you wouldn't think you could paper prototype, but one of my students had a really creative way of doing it. And it encourages really honest feedback, I find, because it looks like shit. And so people will be like, man, I don't really like this game versus a digital prototype. I think people can sense you've put more time into it. And so they want to tell you what they think you want to hear rather than being honest with you. The cons of paper prototyping, it is definitely not very representative of the final game. In the final game, I'm assuming you're not going to have hands moving stuff around. You're not going to be tactilely touching things. In one of the runs of this workshop just a couple of days ago, somebody had a game. They wanted to basically make, like, imagine hungry, hungry hippos. You're mashing a button and eating stuff. That's going to be really hard on paper. But he, in order to represent the concept of, like, hitting stuff as fast as you can, he actually had us type through the Zoom chat. So he would say, you have to type bananas. And then everybody would try to type bananas as fast as possible. Dramatically different game, but it gets some of the same sort of emotional design, the frantic, oh crap, I gotta be the first to do it, that he's looking for in his game. And it actually wound up being really fun. So while that's a decent enough test to see, okay, this sort of frantic emotion that we're trying to go for with this concept seems to be exciting to people, it's definitely not a very representative test. It's not the same as mashing the hungry, hungry hippo button. It's also just challenging to translate some games into paper prototype form. They can't be played without the person. If I make a digital prototype, I can send it to 400 people and get their feedback. If I make a paper prototype, I got to go sit down with each of them individually. And assuming the concept performs well, you wind up translating it to a digital prototype anyway. That's usually the next step. So this is from a game design video that I really like. And I am heavily biased because I am a game designer. But I just want to make this clear to everybody. It's not really that all of our different aspects of game development are balanced. It's more like game design is our skeleton or backbone of a concept, and everything else rests on top. You have all played titles that are absolutely gorgeous, but the game loop is garbage. It's just not fun. We have all experienced that. We've all experienced wonderfully scored games with like beautiful music where the game looks like crap or whatever. The actual core loop, the core interaction that the players are doing is what compels you, is what makes a game interesting and exciting. So a paper prototype is testing that, is testing the game design. You can use it to test other stuff too, but for the most part, this is what we're going to be doing today. So this is a Reddit post that I thought was adorable, and it's a great example of a paper prototype. Remember that you are the game engine. So this dad assumedly made this version of Tetris, and he's allowing his daughter to play. So assuming he just invented Tetris, this is him getting to test if this is an interesting concept. But one of the other reasons I like this is because it actually demonstrates some of paper prototyping. He is acting as the game engine, first of all. He is getting a real test. He gets to see how his daughter interacts and uses these pieces and thinks about this game. And it's not fully representative of what Tetris actually is. So, you know, the lines are not disappearing when she gets a full row. There's no music. It's not true random pieces. There's only so many pieces you can actually drop in there. It's not timed. There's a lot of the core elements that make Tetris Tetris that are missing, but he still gets to test that core loop, that core game design is the core core nugget of what this game is actually compelling. And it seems like it is. She loves it. So this is I'm not expecting you to put together a big cardboard thing. This is more akin to what I'm expecting you to actually make tonight. So this is a paper prototype of this interesting little game where you like explore a world and can change the time of day. I want to make it very clear because somebody asked about this in one of the other runs of this workshop. I am not expecting you. You should not be making menus or loading screens. Think about the utility of your tests. Complete such a waste of time to test the loading screen, unless I guess you wanted to test if somebody is willing to sit through a loading screen, I guess would be the utility of testing that. And even all this UI is way over the top of what you actually need. For the most part, what we're doing tonight is simply testing the core game design, like I've been saying. So it is not a test of the core game design to see if they understand the UI. If you're testing the UI, then make a test about the UI. But otherwise, test what you actually need to get out of it, that hypothesis that you have. This could be a fun game. So this is a bit of what you should be making. I think you can make something just like this. Maybe do something like this where you're upgrading the character, but even this is probably more than you need for a simple test. All right, I'm gonna pick on one of you. One of you is gonna play my paper prototype. Who wants to volunteer to be the brave soul? Amazing. I'm going to call somebody out. All right. I see Nelson. Thank you, Nelson. Nelson, how are you today?
I'm doing good.
Fantastic. All right. Let me turn off my background here. Currently sitting in at my dining room table. If you're wondering about that background. So I have a very straightforward paper prototype. The first time we ran this workshop, I had somebody to help me run the workshop, and he designed a game, and I think his game was much better than my game, but hey, we're going to go with it anyway. All right, so this is first of all a demo of a prototype, second of all a demo of a playtest, and third of all a demo of how to playtest paper prototypes through webcams, because we're all here in this modern time period where this has to happen. So Nelson, you are currently playing a game called Quick Dungeon. In Quick Dungeon, you have a You have a deck of cards that are actually dice, and you're going to fight monsters and explore this dungeon. All right.
Okay.
The first thing I need you to do is to pick your class. You can be a warrior, standard with a lot of health. You can be a mage, not much health but big damage. Or you can be a rogue, high risk, high reward.
I'm feeling risky, so I'm gonna do rogue.
It is hilarious. Literally every person who has playtested this is broke. That right there, by the way, is one of the things you should be looking for. Maybe your other two classes are not interesting enough, or maybe you just make a game about rogues. All right. So the rogue starts with 1d20, 1d10, 1d6, and then 3d4. This is the high risk, high reward part. The way this works, this is your deck. I'm going to shuffle it up. You're going to get three of them randomly into your hand. The other ones are still in your deck. All right?
Okay.
So currently you have a 10, a 20, and a 4. You can, when you are not in combat, you can move in any direction that has a valid pathway. So right now your only valid pathway is to the north. And when you enter a room, I'll tell you what happens next.
All right.
Where would you like to move?
I'll choose the first location, north.
All right, that makes sense. Oh, snap, you ran into a goblin. Oh, no. All right, so here's how combat works in this game. It's literally just rolling off. The higher roll wins. You get to choose a die from your hand to use. Once you use it will go into your discard until you reshuffle. Goblin will pick a random die to use. He's going to use either a d4 or a d6, and he will tell you what he's using before you pick. He is using a d6.
Okay.
What would you like to roll?
I'm going to roll I have a d20, d6, and a d4.
You have a d20, a d10, and a d4.
Okay, I'll do d10.
All right. Let's see what happens. You wrecked your shit, man. Wow. All right. So in this game, you also never recover health. So you started at 7, you lose one health, you're down to 6. You got to fight another round with a goblin. He's only got one health, but he's kicking your butt.
Okay, awesome.
You'll draw another card into your hand. We'll say you got a d6. The d10 goes to your discard, which he is going to choose what he's doing. Oh, he's using a d4 this time.
Okay, I'm also going to roll d4.
All right, d4, make it d4. This is you. Dark rogue. You got a 3. You got a 1, man. Goblin is kicking your butt. All right. That d4 goes in the discard. You draw something from your hand. All you've got left is d4s.
Yeah.
Goblin also gets a d4 again. What would you like to roll?
I think I'm going to roll a d4.
All right. We'll say same thing. You are the black one.
Mm-hmm.
All right, you're down to 4 health. This is one gnarly goblin. You have discarded this other d4. The last die in your deck gets drawn into your hand. The goblin is going to use a d6 again. What would you like to use?
I'm gonna use d20.
All right, let's wreck this goblin. You got a 9. You got a 4. Awesome. He is finally dead. Congratulations. Normally, you would move to another room and keep fighting stuff and finding other dice to add to your deck. But for the sake of today, that'll conclude our playtest. Congratulations. You did amazing.
Thank you. It's a hard game.
Not really. You actually did terribly. Thank you so much. Let's get claps for Nelson for the bravery.
Thank you.
For his incredible play of the week fighting that goblin. Okay. So that is a paper prototype, and that is an example of how you can play your paper prototypes despite the fact that COVID is a thing. And it's just a lot easier, even if you're not affected by COVID as much in your area and you're more comfortable going to places in person, it's a great utility to be able to play games online because you never know where you're going to find people who are willing to play test. That being said, I will say that playtesting in person is incredibly valuable. You learn a lot more by sitting down with someone in the real world and testing the game. Yeah, that's the goblin that is going to get wind up like being adopted by the party. Everyone's going to love it. They're going to name it Boblin. Will be the ongoing NPC. We are going to talk about concept funnels now. Wow, amazing. So concept funneling is this is really sort of why you use paper prototyping. This is why I decided to include this as a part of today's lecture. A concept funnel is a way for us to take our many ideas and pick just one. An amateur game developer, somebody who just stepped into the space, so common for somebody to just pick a concept and be like, yes, I love that concept. I'm going to work on that for the next 6 months. And then they're upset that one, games always take so much longer than we think. So they think it's going to take 6 months, then it takes literally 3 years. That is a real example, by the way. My brother and I had a 6 month game that took literally 3 years. And it's also just, it's not, even if it was 6 months, you might as well spend some time to do some real due diligence and be like, yes, this is a game that I am confident is going to be worth these 6 months. So a game dev god or goddess or anything in between actually spends time going through a tried and true and established vetting process to choose which game is the most promising. So this would be a concept funnel that might get used in the industry. This is one that my own personal indie studio used. We started by coming up with a bunch of different concepts. Then once we have a lot of different game concepts, we use what's called a filter list, which we're going to do really quickly here in a second, to reduce it down to 10 or so. From those 10, we can paper prototype 4 or 5 of them pretty easily. We can do that in a day or two, test a couple of them via paper prototyping. Then once we're pretty confident we know which of those is really exciting, we can actually invest a couple of weeks to do some digital prototyping, and then from there choose the top concept. So that is a concept funnel. Now we're going to use a hyper simplified version of it today. Today you're going to brainstorm 10 or more games. Then we're going to filter list it to our top three. Then you're going to pick one and actually prototype it and play it with somebody here in the room. All right. So brainstorming, I'm not going to talk about much because assumedly you all, does everybody know what brainstorming is? All right, you come up with ideas. when you brainstorm, I recommend you time box your brainstorming sessions. I recommend you bring new eyes into the room with you to do brainstorming. It really helps to have ideas to kind of bounce off of. Segment your time. So do like a 15-minute brainstorming session, take a little break, come back, do it again. It really helps come up with fresh ideas that way. So John, at the very beginning of our session here, mentioned constraints in his PowerPoint. That constraints are a powerful part of what gets us creative. Who here has done a game jam in the past? Anybody? I'm seeing Jordan, amazing. Jim has done one. I can't see your name. Is that Eric? Eric has done one. Nelson has done one, great. For anyone else who I'm not seeing, game jams are actually amazing. Of the three things that I recommend people to help break into the industry, game jams are one of them, just finish games. And what part of the reason that game jams are so amazing is because they force you to get creative. If I just say, come up with a game concept, somebody quickly tell me a game concept. Come on.
Slapping flies.
Amazing. Amazing. But we saw how that was kind of challenging just to be like, it could be anything. But if instead I say, come up with an RPG, give me an RPG twist. Not really demonstrating my point. My point is, with constraints, we wind up breeding creativity. And if you've been in a game jam, you know this to be true. So by being given our constraints, it actually helps us come up with concepts we never would have thought of before. So our constraints for tonight are pretty straightforward. Number one, you have to be able to actually paper prototype it. So unfortunately, you won't be working on a first-person shooter tonight. Unless you can somehow convince me that you can turn that into a paper prototype, I will be very impressed if you do so. It needs to be able to be played over Zoom. So either turn your camera down to the piece of paper, or you can do what I was showing earlier, a digital paper prototype. So you can build something on your computer. You need to be able to create the prototype with whatever you have. So if you need a timer, you have to be able to find a timer. You can use your phone, for instance. And then I'm going to add a secret theme here in a second. So we're going to do 5 minutes of what's called divergent brainstorming, which basically just means you're aiming for quantity over quality. It's a complicated way to say, I'm going to brainstorm as many ideas as I can as quickly as possible. So all I want you to do for the next 5 minutes, I'm going to put you in a random breakout room so that you guys can start to build some camaraderie. This is going to be the same breakout room you are in for the rest of the day until you're actually playing your games with other people. So start to get to know these people a little bit and bounce ideas off of each other. You know, maybe shout out some of your favorite ideas, ask each other what they're working on. You'll have 5 minutes to try to come up with as many ideas as you can. And I'm going to ask you to put these ideas in this filter list. And we'll talk about what exactly the filter list means in just a second. Poblin the Goblin. So this is a filter list. I'm going to tell you more about it in a bit. You can ignore all of this for right now. Just ignore it. But go ahead and make yourself a copy by going up to File and then Make a Copy. And as you come up with game ideas tonight, I want you to write them in the left-hand side. So game name and brief description. You can write, you know, goblin fighter, fight goblins and make friends or whatever. All right. And you can delete the ideas that I already had. And you can, once again, you can ignore all of this for now. We're going to talk about that a little bit later. All you're trying to do is get as many ideas in this list as possible. Okay. All right. So the gods of Zoom are going to put everybody into a random breakout room. We have 16 people. So let's do 4 rooms. You will have 5 minutes. I'm going to do a timer and I will pop around through the rooms a little bit. You are just trying to come up with as many ideas that you could paper prototype tonight as possible. Okay. The secret theme, it's like we're doing a game jam, is 3 minutes or less. This must be a game that you can play in 3 minutes or less, unless you can come up with some other creative application of the term 3 minutes or less. All right. So a game you can paper prototype must be able to be played in 3 minutes or less. The Zoom gods have spoken. The rooms are open. You have 5 minutes. Felipe just came out of the ground. All right. Just answering random messages while I wait for them to do their brainstorming. I'm going to give them until 2:10. This is my 5th event this week. Can you see the bags? I got 2 more meetings after this. All right. I'm gonna do like 10 more seconds and then I'll close the rooms. closing the rooms. They have 60 seconds. They have 20 seconds. That's good. That means they're trying to get to 7. Welcome back. I'm seeing some smiles. I'm not seeing any fists. This is good. Fantastic. All right, so let's hear a couple of ideas. What did people come up with? How many did we get also? Raise your hand if you hit 7. Oh, that's all right. Oh, okay, Corey, big overachiever. I'm just kidding. Great job, Corey. Don't worry if you didn't come up with 7 ideas. You will have something that you can paper prototype tonight. This is largely to give you some extra goodies, some extra... some extra lingo, some extra exercises that you can do when you're working in the future. So let's hear one or two ideas. I would love to hear one. Who wants to share a concept? All right, Corey. Oh, you're muted, Corey. I was like...
It wasn't perfect. Letting me unmute, sorry. Yes, we got sleep driving, mushroom harvest, horror driving, like visceral driving, and then like bone mancy, bone crafting type thing.
Ooh, very interesting. To be clear, this maybe wasn't clear. You are all working on your own games tonight. You can definitely share ideas and everything, but just you said we, so wanted to make sure you've got some of your own concepts in there.
Oh, yeah, no, what we were bouncing off each other.
Okay, perfect. That's just what we want. I love bone mancy. That's really interesting. Back in Diablo 2 days, I always chose Necromancer, even though he also was the most boring character. Any other ideas? Let's get like 2 more. It's great to share.
My group had a few. One was save the town in 3 minutes. You have 3 minutes to collect certain items to save a town from like a monster, and some items like, increase your time, but
okay.
You start with 3 minutes and then you have to like kind of go from there, but nothing. Yeah. As the clock counts down, like maybe you could go back up to 3 minutes, but you can't really like go past that. Yeah.
Interesting. So like Godzilla comes marching into town and you're like, oh gosh, better get the Godzilla repellent.
Yeah. Yeah. Basically.
Nice. Sounds cool. All right. Let's get one more.
I was part of Corey's group and I had the idea of the visceral drag racing. So it'd be like, it was kind of like a Mad Max kind of thing where instead of like drag race, like you're racing against each other in a quarter mile, it's more like you're playing the game of chicken and you're basically just like racing like towards each other.
Interesting. It's like jag race jousting. That could be pretty cool. So that is a great example of what we are going to do next, which is another like just 2 minutes or so to do convergent brainstorming. Once again, trying to give you a couple fancy words so that the next job interview you're in, you sound very fancy. Convergent brainstorming is another big word for the opposite of what you just did. You are still brainstorming, but now it's about quality over quantity. And in particular, if you were in the industry, if you were in a studio and you were doing this brainstorming with a couple of different people, which for instance, at Lumosity, we would usually have a 2-week time period where we were coming up with a concept before we even started prototyping the top concepts. So 2-week period where it's just about basically brainstorming and vetting these ideas. And when we did brainstorming sessions, I would grab a couple of people and I would usually grab fresh people. So I'd grab, Bob from the, app development team, even though he doesn't do games, because fresh minds in a room help so much. And then we would enter this room together. We would come up with as many games as we could. And then once we did that, we would converge those ideas. So the most common way that this gets used is if we've got a bunch of sticky notes, each with a game, if you imagine that, And then I go, okay, these four games are kind of the same thing. So let's condense those into one solid idea. These two things are kind of the same thing. This game is really interesting. And I actually think there's two different ways this could go. That's what convergent brainstorming is. It's using the ideas that you already have and kind of elaborating on them and condensing them. And it's more about getting solid concepts at this point rather than just any concept. But you still are going to filter these games. That's going to be the next step after this. So it's still good to have ideas on there. Don't cross out any ideas. The chicken, the car racing chicken that we just got mentioned, turning into car jousting is a perfect example of convergent brainstorming and is a perfect way of how you can bounce ideas off of each other. So if one person says car racing, you can add, ooh, what if you got to joust each other with sticks? That would be cool. So you're going to have, we'll just say like 2 or 3 minutes. We won't use up too much time on this to come up with another couple of ideas. Does everybody feel like they get what's going on? All right. I am going to open the rooms back up and I will bring you back in just about 2 or 3 minutes. See if you can hit 10. I'll be very proud of you if you do. It's easy to hit 10 if you don't care about how bad the ideas are. All right, rooms are open. Welcome back again. Fancy seeing you here. All right. Welcome back, everybody. Let's get one or two more. Who had one or two more ideas during their convergent brainstorming session?
Yeah. Took it from the idea of being like a just like a necromancy thing, but for like digging bones and pieces, building a Frankenstein type monster.
Nice.
And then turning that into like a tower defense against waves, see how tough your dude is.
That's pretty cool. I like that. Has anyone done any modding in any games? Yes, no? That's a great way to get started in game development.
Yeah,
it's a great way to get started in game development. One of the things that I used to love was modding Skyrim, which is just so fun because you can turn it into such a different game. You made me think of a playthrough that I did as a White Walker. I would walk into towns and I would destroy everything and then raise an army and then go to the next town. It only lasted like 6 hours because everyone was dead after that. But it was awesome for 6 hours. Surya, I saw you raise your hand.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Game concept?
Yeah. So I think the first time it was kind of pretty short. By the time we were introduced ourselves and stuff, I think the time was pretty much over. So we came up with a total of two concepts so far.
Okay.
I'll just start off. So one is that you have a bomb diffuser thing, a little bit like keep talking and nobody explodes. So you have actions that you need to do to try to defuse the bomb, but each one takes a certain amount of time. So time is your currency.
Okay.
Go over 3 minutes, you blew up.
Amazing. Beautiful. Awesome. All right. Thank you both for sharing. Let's jump back in and talk about filter lists. All right. So a filter list is a, if you remember, this is our simplified concept funnel for today. Brainstorm a bunch of ideas, filter those ideas, pick one to paper prototype. A filter list is one of the simplest ways to filter ideas. I actually ran into this from Supercell, the guys who make Clash Royale. I read an article by them a long time ago about how they choose concepts and how they filter those concepts. And they didn't actually provide a filter list. So I wound up sort of reverse engineering what I think they were talking about. And over the years of me doing game development, it's now turned into a very simple tool that I really, really like. So when you have lots of concepts, the way that you vet those ideas and reduce them down, there's many of them. We can actually physically prototype those concepts like we're doing now. We can survey people to see what they think of ideas. One that I really like that I only learned about a couple of years ago is market testing, which means putting up a fake ad for a game that doesn't exist to see if people like it. You can play test these games with people in person. There's lots of ways for us to actually vet or test if a concept is compelling to our target market, to whoever we're trying to get to play our game. Or we can test to find out who our target market is, who would actually like this game. Filter listing is, for me anyway, now a hallmark tool. The job that I just got at Together Labs, the newest place that I'm working, part of what I did for them as a sort of test to show off what I do is I filter listed a bunch of different ideas. And it was a simple way for me to look like I knew what I was talking about. Hopefully I do know what I'm talking about, but it's a very powerful tool. Pros of this thing are that it takes almost no time to get some concept of how promising a game idea is, how good it is, but it's highly biased and it's the least comprehensive. It's not a excellent tool. So I'm gonna just show you an existing filter list. You guys have a very simple one here, but to show you an actual production list, I have a, among the 15,000 things that I do, one of the things I do is I have my own little studio. We recently successfully funded a QR code enabled dungeon crawling board game on Kickstarter. And this is the list that originally led to that idea. So the list is pretty simple. You put down all your ideas. Here's a bunch of our different ideas. So, you know, the very top idea, Obregon Trail, it's just Oregon Trail except in space, because Oregon Trail was awesome. Then you will list your filters, the things you actually care about, your objectives for this game. So we cared about a game that we could ship pretty easily. It's a team of three, and then we hired some other people, but for the most part, just three people. We wanted a game that we thought could make money upside. We wanted a game that we thought would hook people. We wanted a game that we thought people would replay. We wanted a game that we were excited to work on, and we wanted a game that we could prototype and test relatively easily. Then this is not something you will do tonight, but if you want to take your filter lists further in the future, you can also weigh each of your filters. So how important these filters actually are. So what I'm saying here is that my personal excitement is worth four times as much as the replayability in my mind for these concepts. And then you literally just score each of these concepts in each of these different filter categories. So here's Obregon Trail again. These are the different filters, the different categories. You can see that Oregon Trail was very easy to ship. This is a random tidbit, but something that I still do to this day. I always score out of six instead of out of five, because if I do it out of five, a three is a perfect middle ground. If I do it out of six, I am forced to make it a little bit positive or a little bit negative. I don't allow partials. I don't allow a 6.5. So that's something that you can do yourself if you want. So a six is a perfect score. This Obregon Trail will be super easy to ship compared to these other games. That's all you're doing compared to the other concepts in this list. I don't think it'll make much money. I don't think people will think it's that exciting. I don't think people will replay it very long. I kind of think it's neat, I guess. Definitely easy to prototype. So that's all we do. In this case, we got a little bit more advanced. We had each of the core stakeholders, the core shareholders, people making the game decisions, score the games individually. Then we had those games all get stuck together, all get averaged out. And then we use that to actually get a rank of how promising we think these different game titles are. So Escape Velocity Battle Royale was our number one concept, which we did prototype, and it was fucking awesome. But unfortunately, we needed a pretty serious, consistent, concurrent user base to make any kind of Battle Royale game work. And as an indie studio, we knew we wouldn't be able to do that, so we didn't go with this game. We actually wound up going with this one. If you heard what I mentioned earlier, we made basically a QR code-enabled dungeon crawling board game, and it was the 15th on our list, not very high on the list. So the reason that I point that out is because there's many other reasons to work on games. This is just, once again, one tool in your tool chest. So all you're gonna do tonight is you can see here, I have some explanation of what these different things mean on your list. I want you to just run down your list now and score each of your games in these different categories. Once you have finished doing so, you can talk with a group, look at what your top three concepts are. You can talk with a group a little bit. And then with your extra time, I want you to choose the one game you're going to paper prototype in the next section. All right, sound good? All right, I'm gonna give you just a couple of minutes. Try to make this more, is there a question?
Yeah, I was just wondering, do we each make our own sheet? And are we choosing to make these independently or with a group? Mm-hmm.
You will make the games independently. Mm-hmm. So that's the end all be all. Besides that, you can do what you want. If you all wanna score the games together, you could do that. If you all kind of agree on a general score. If you want to do the exercise yourself, go ahead and make a copy of the list. You see how we did it to combine all of our scores. This is more advanced than I would recommend you get right now. This is, once again, just to learn the exercise. All right. Try to do it quickly. Don't think about it too much. It's just an exercise. And remember that these are all compared to each other. So a Gesha Combat, I think these are garbage. These are fake scores, but hypothetically, Gesha Combat is something like 2.5 times as easy to ship as Colored Squares, right? That's all you're doing. You don't need to get, don't get stuck in the weeds trying to figure out everything. Just do it quickly. All right, the rooms are open. I'm gonna give you just a couple of minutes and then I'll come through and check where people are at. Hello, Dehane. The students are all in a breakout room right now. They're coming back in about 40 seconds. So we can sit here awkwardly together for a second.
Sorry, I'm a little late.
It's okay, how you doing?
I'm very good.
All right. Have you done paper prototyping before?
Not really. I'm actually a programmer.
Okay.
I do Unreal development in Unreal. So I thought, okay, you know what, why just explore different avenues?
Yeah.
Probably try designing for a bit.
Uh-huh. Game design is good stuff. I love game design.
Yeah.
That's great. Yeah. We are, so I can give you like a little bit, sort of a Spark Notes version.
Okay.
We're about to have the students come back and then they're all going to start working on games. So once they do that, I'll give you the Spark Notes version and we'll throw you in a room. Welcome back, everybody. How'd the filter list go?
That was an interesting exercise.
Yeah, it's such a simple one. But it really, it's a great way to start wrapping your head around what you think of the different concepts, and adding different filters and weighting those different filters helps get a little bit more depth to those decisions as well. What are some of your top concepts? Oh, Jordan, do you have a question?
Oh, I had just had a comment on it.
Yeah, go ahead.
On the filter list. I found it like kind of, when I was working on it, like on my own, I found it a little difficult because depending on what the like criteria are.
Yeah.
Like you said, I think there's a lot of bias into like into the criteria. Like if it's ease of shipping and marketability, I don't have a whole lot of like game dev experience. So I don't know, I don't really know what is easily shippable and what is marketable. So
yep.
I know what I'm personally excited about, but mm-hmm. it's sort of like as a new person in this space, like I found that a little bit difficult.
Yeah, that makes sense. Well, number one, you know, you'll just get better as you continue to work your way into the space. Mm-hmm. But number two, I think I think just something that comes with filter listing is knowing that there is bias. And so once again, not using this as the end all be all tool, but instead use it just as like, okay, from my best guess, it sure seems like this is going to be easier to make and this is going to be harder to make. And it sure seems like this game is more exciting to the team and this game is less exciting. So it's just simply a way to get some extra metrics. When you guys work as game designers in the space, something that will happen very quickly is that everyone wants to know why you are choosing the different games or concepts or whatever that you are doing. And being able to show something like this is an easy way to add a little bit of validity to your decisions. All right, what are some of the top concepts that you guys came up with? Let's hear one or two top games.
So I called that one Necro Fence, but in just like spitballing some things to add some things in there to like rate.
Yeah.
Came up with the drifting plus the driving that was the two ideas were thrown out early.
Uh-huh.
Called it drifting off to sleep, and it's Don't Wake Daddy meets like Weekend at Bernie's in a Rush style driving simulator.
That sounds awesome. Wow, great. By the way, I saw that Paul or somebody else left earlier. Yeah, Paul had left earlier, and that Austin, you're gonna have to take off soon. So I normally wait until the end for this, but for the sake of anyone who's leaving a little bit early, now that I know all of you are cool people, you are cordially invited to the Indie Game Academy Discord. We are a bunch of goofs. You know, we think we're Jedi or something. We're trying to make the world better with our video games and make the game industry better. So you're welcome to join there. And then the other thing that I always offer after workshops is a one-on-one call with me. So 30-minute consultation. Generally, I talk about career. So I try to help people break into the game industry. But if you want to chat with me for whatever reason, feel free to use that link. So if you have to take off early, feel free to use those. I love that concept, though. That is, I am intrigued by how it actually gets put together. Amazing. All right, so it's about time for us to actually build out a paper prototype. So let me give you some last words of encouragement, and then I'm going to stick you into your breakout rooms, and you'll have a full 20 minutes to make a paper prototype that you will then test with the room, test with somebody in this room, possibly two people, depending on how we do on time. So here we go. Making a paper prototype, actually putting one together. There are a couple things that make a paper prototype a solid paper prototype. Number one is what I was talking about earlier. Remember that this is founded from a hypothesis and it has testable elements. The whole purpose of this is to prove or disprove something. Tonight, what we're primarily proving or disproving is, could this game be fun? And I use the term could for a very particular reason. A lot of the time, your paper prototypes are going to be garbage. They're not actually going to be fun yet. It's not quite a representative test yet. So you're not necessarily, if somebody is having a blast with your game, even when it's on paper that you threw together in 15 minutes, you know this is a solid game concept. But even if you can just see some of the nuggets, even if you can see like, okay, I think there's some magic here, then that's still a promising concept. So your key hypothesis tonight should be, could this game be fun? This prototype should answer specific questions, focuses on player feedback, and it answers some of those fundamental questions. Does everybody know what a game loop is? Do I need to talk about that at all? Ish. Yeah, so the short definition, actually, does anyone want to explain? Do we want to hear from the room?
Yeah, it's your game state management, where you're at a menu or some base scenario where you're going to hit a play button, you're going to venture out, you're going to accomplish an objective, and it's going to return you to that base state. Could be where you're starting at your save point, you know, making it to the next boss, defeating or not defeating them. And either way, it's going to either take you to the next level or put you back at your save point. Mm-hmm. And it's just like that iterative sort of progress management.
Yeah, a game loop, it's sort of interesting. This is such a fundamental to game design, but there are so many people who use it in so many different ways. For the most part, a game loop is simply what is the player going to be doing over and over again? So for instance, this is Talemore, the board game that we published semi-recently that I was talking about. It has this sort of light team-based combat. So on a particular turn, this is the digital paper prototype I was showing you, if I can get out of it. On a particular turn, the players are all going to do one thing. We were inspired by Slay the Spire for this combat. So all the enemies show you what they're going to do. So like this guy is going to stab the rogue. You're going to choose just one ability to use. So turn begins, enemies display their moves. The players all choose just one move and then the attacks resolve. And that's the loop, just happens over and over again, right? We do that until we win or we all die, and then we'll enter into a different loop or into a larger loop. Sometimes there are loops within loops. Regardless, the reason that I mention this is oftentimes an easy place to start if you're not sure how to put together a paper prototype is to conceive of what the loop is. What is the thing the player is going to do over and over again, and then how can I test it? So an example a little bit earlier that I, actually, let me save that for just one more second. So the biggest questions that you're seeking to answer is, like I said, I already sort of gave this part of the lecture, could this game be fun? You're just trying to figure out, could this make people laugh? Could this make people enjoy themselves? Or if you're building a Souls-like or some other kind of game, you're looking to fulfill those emotional objectives. Does this piss people off, but do they still not quit? Secondly, you're looking for magic moments. And this is one that I separate from fun for a very particular reason, but for a similar reason. You are looking for those special moments that happen in the gameplay that could turn into a more significant part of the game. That's what a magic moment is, or a golden nugget, we'll also sometimes call it. So an example, and this is a perfect example of a paper prototype that you may not have expected. A student of mine, a couple cohorts back, wanted to make a game similar to Goat Simulator. Do people know what Goat Simulator is? Basically like super stupid, super goofy. You're a goat walking around a town and you like throw people off their chairs and run into them and You can like use your tongue to pull stuff around. It's really weird. The whole purpose is to be super weird and stupid. So he wanted to make something like that where you are a kitten on a space station. That was his concept. And so you're like messing with the escape pods and screwing with the oxygen. And, you know, it's just meant to be super stupid. So that would be really hard to paper prototype. What he wound up coming up with that I love and I still use as an example is just a single piece of paper with four buttons on it. And then during the actual play test, he holds up the piece of paper and he says, "You are a kitten exploring a space station and you find a control panel with four buttons on it. What do you do?" So he gives them the thematics of the game. He allows them to imagine, he allows their imagination to be the game engine, and he just shows them one choice moment in the game. And so the players hit some buttons, random things happen, the coffee machine stops working, but then they hit one button in particular and he switches to a different picture and it's an exploding space station. And he goes, "Oh dear, you hit the self-destruct button." And like 9 times out of 10, that got a laugh out of the person playing. They were sort of surprised. They thought it was really fun. So that's a successful paper prototype and a successful magic moment. He discovered a golden nugget. Really like damaging the space station and screwing with these astronauts' lives was hilarious. And so that's what you should actually focus on and try to create more of in your final game. So that's an example, like get creative with how you actually use a paper prototype. How can I demonstrate the same emotional impact and the same player choices just on paper? And the last thing you're looking for that sometimes people don't think about are risks. So what could sink this game? If people consistently don't understand what the hell they're supposed to do, that's a problem, that's a risk. You know, maybe you could massage the tutorial and make it better in the future. But if you are spending 5 minutes in an 8-minute play test to describe how to play the game, that could be a valid reason to simply not make this game, right? So you're looking for the good stuff and looking for the bad stuff. So it's time to actually make a paper prototype. I'm going to stick you back into your rooms. I might shuffle the rooms a little bit because we have, we've just had, what is your name? Dehanesh. Nice to meet you. We're going to stick him into one of the rooms and then I think Logan has to take off soon.
Yeah, so, I do.
All right. So Jim, I might move you into a different room then. All right.
Yeah.
All right. You're going to have 20 minutes to make a paper prototype. You can either make it digitally like I showed you, or you can actually make it on paper as long as you have the ability to actually play this game with other people here in this room over Zoom, whether it's pointing the camera at a piece of paper or whatever else you want to do. For anybody else, does anyone have questions about what they're doing or does everyone feel good?
So again, we're going to the rooms and we're yep. going to create our individual games with like chatting with other folks as yeah. like inspiration or help.
Yep. Okay. Yeah, that's really it. It's just, we try to, the Indiegame Academy is entirely online, but I personally started my teaching journey in person. So it's really just a way to try to get some of the magic of having other people around, you know, feeling their energy, getting ideas from them. So each of you, to be very clear, is making your own paper prototype. It's just you, but you're in a room to get inspiration, to ask questions, et cetera, while you work. All right?
And multiple people making the same concept is fine. Like if a particular concept got a lot of personal excitement from a lot of sure. people.
Yeah. I mean, different interpretations of the same game are actually really valuable sometimes.
Fair.
Corey, were you asking something?
Yeah. So if we were putting this together in it, like if it's on paper or something, how are we going to interact with it? Just verbally telling the person in front of the camera to do this to XY?
Yeah. So the example that I showed of the quick dungeon prototype is how you would have to build it. So you're going to have to build something that either you can control for them via verbal commands or you know, some other interpretation. So I mentioned earlier, somebody wanted to make hungry, hungry hippos. That's basically impossible to paper prototype. Mm-hmm. At least over the camera, you could have made something with like a claw that people are grabbing with just out of paper, I guess. But at least over camera, that's impossible. So what he did instead to kind of make a representative paper prototype is you just have to type as fast as you can to get the different pieces of food. So get creative with how you can present different game concepts, but one way or another, you're going to have to be able to play it here through the camera.
Okay. And is there a like a digital sort of like a sprite screen thing like you're showing or something like that we can use to like drag drop things that we just sketch out real quick?
That's a good question. There's a lot of different tools out there. I actually often just use this, which is just Google Docs. What do they call this one? Just Google Drawings. Okay. It's a nice simple space. It doesn't give you much room, but it's generally enough for a simple prototype like this. But then there's other tools out there. Envision is one of the good ones. If there's other wireframe tools that you guys use, that can often be used. Austin, got a question?
Sorry. You good? No, the thing is that, like I said, I would have to leave at 3, so I'm leaving at 15 minutes, so I don't think I have enough time to actually work on it, but it's all right. I can just, like, at the very least, like, list out ideas of what I could do to paper for, like, for example, like, what kind of, like, if I would use a specific card deck, if I'll be using, like, dice, whatever, it would be okay if I just at least list it out.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, yeah. Cool. All
right. Yeah, I think use the time as you can. If you have to leave in 15 minutes, maybe start working on one. Or writing out different ways that you could prototype it is great. And we can talk a little bit about it before you go. Whatever feels right to you.
Got it. No problem.
Yep. All right. And if you are leaving early, make sure to join the Discord and schedule a call with me. That'd be great. You have 20 minutes starting now. The rooms are open. I'm going to have to move Jim. All right. All right, Hanesh.
How does this work?
Yes, yeah. I'm going to give you the very quick version, and then I'm going to stick you in a room, okay? So, a paper prototype. Are you familiar with that at all?
I've heard of it. I know a little bit of it.
A little bit. Just okay. Little bit. So, a prototype in general is just a tool that we use to vet an idea. It's a tool that we use to go, okay, this idea could be good. And the idea doesn't necessarily need to be an entire game. So it could just be, we're testing if this new menu makes sense, or we're testing if the tutorial makes sense, or whatever, some aspect of the game rather than the whole game. And we do that to reduce risk so that we don't wind up working on a game that sucks for a year. We're basically trying to pick the best of the bunch before we actually commit to an idea. Makes sense? Right. So paper prototyping is just one of our tools to do that, to test if a game concept is exciting, could be exciting. It's similar to wireframing. The whole idea is to get a visual representation of what the game is without having to code anything. So trying to make it as quick as possible, trying not to lean on the engineers too much, trying to have a little bit more autonomy as a game designer so that you can iron out a concept before handing it off to somebody to build it. There are a couple examples I'll show you here. So this is a high school game concept. And you can see that they're building some kind of puzzle platformer. I'm not exactly sure what the game is, but some kind of puzzle platformer that these people are actually playing in real time with some pieces of paper.
Right. Yeah, you can see that.
Yeah. The pros, I'll give you the quick version, very fast. Negatives, not very representative. There's a lot of games that are very hard to put into paper prototype form.
Sure.
I often talk about, I'm a game designer, so I'm biased, but I often talk about how the game design is really, that's the core product. If the game isn't fun, then you can have immaculate code and it won't matter.
True.
If the game isn't fun, you can have beautiful visuals and, you know, no one's going to play it still. So
yeah, I agree with you.
The reason we do this is to make sure the game's actually fun.
Yeah.
A couple other cute ones. This is one I found on Reddit that I still like to show off. So this could be considered a paper prototype for Tetris, right? It's obviously very elaborate. This is an example. And one of the reasons I like this is because it shows some of how paper prototyping works. You act as the game engine. You actually like play the game for the person to see what they think of it. You get feedback from them. So the dad can see this kid loves this, but it's not fully representative. So, you know, the lines in Tetris normally disappear when you get them. In this, it doesn't do that. There's no timer. It's not true random. The dad's just grabbing pieces. There's a lot of ways that this is inferior to a digital prototype, but it still gets you a very quick test.
Sure.
And then this was my final example of one. This is way more complicated than you actually need to make tonight. For instance, it doesn't make any sense unless you are literally testing the menu. there's no reason to make a menu. Or unless you are literally testing the loading screen, why would you have a loading screen in your paper prototype? Maybe you're testing to see if they'll sit through it. No. But so this is an example, like it's a little bit ugly, but it gets the point across. I don't think you even really need like buttons, once again, unless you're testing buttons. Oftentimes I just have the player like move the piece around, stuff like that. But it's a great example of something a little bit more challenging to create. It's a little RPG game. And here's a paper prototype of it.
So people actually do this?
Yeah, people do this.
All the time, like when you actually design
it? It very much varies per company. There are some companies that don't bother with this at all. But this is something that it doesn't span a lot of time. Usually, like if I'm talking about the entire production process of a game, if let's say we have a year to build the game, probably a month at maximum is the whole process for choosing the game.
Right.
Maybe a little bit more than that. I advocate for more time than less time for that. So all the prototyping, all of the filter listing, all of the brainstorming is happening just in 1 month. And of that 1 month, you're probably only spending a couple of days paper prototyping. But it's once again just to try to reduce risk. So even building a digital prototype, as you well know, can take a couple of days, can take a week. So we want to make sure that those couple of days, that week is actually worth it. That's really the idea. At Lumosity, which is where a big part of my professional experience came from, we would do this at the very beginning of our production cycle. So usually we did like 8 to 9 months per game. The first month would be coming up with a concept and vetting it. And in that time, we would do some paper prototyping.
So I have a question.
Yeah.
I don't know if I'll really get those 20 minutes to make a prototype this today because I'm already very late. I'm really sorry for that.
That's okay.
But I do have a question. So let's say you're building a game like Hades, for example.
Yes.
It's an isometric game. You already know what you kind of going for. Does paper prototyping make sense then in such kind of situations?
That's a great question. It depends. It's if the concept is like, I'm going to make an RPG game and I know I'm going to make an RPG game, there's no need to paper prototype an RPG game if that decision has already been made. What I would actually paper prototype is like individual aspects. So assumedly there's something that's special about your RPG game, you know, that's different than all the others. That's what I would focus on to actually prototype. Yeah, so I would, the cat thing that I just talked about as an example, like I could just start building the cat game and basically just make Goat Simulator and it would probably be a very respectable game. But before investing that time, I am gonna at least test if people think it's funny that a kitten is blowing up a space station. Yeah, so oftentimes I'm not building an elaborate prototype of like an actual RPG with actual enemies and stuff, because that's kind of just a waste of time. Like you're gonna wind up turning that into digital anyway pretty quickly. So really you're just looking for like as close to representative as possible. How can I test if somebody actually thinks this is compelling?
So the idea is to actually make something like this and show it to people and, you know, try and gauge whether they enjoy this or not.
Exactly. Yeah. So like I said, a lot of my professional career was here at Lumosity. And this is like a perfect kind of studio where you would paper prototype. All these games are really, really small. So this was one of my final games. Actually, this one was pretty much impossible to paper prototype, but I'll show other examples. This is another one that I created called Fuse Clues, which is about basically recognizing number patterns. I don't need the tutorial. I made the damn game. Give it a second. We were probably the most dramatic of all the production teams. So in this game, all you're actually doing is trying to recognize patterns of numbers. So you have to fill in these spaces. So this is an example where we did build paper prototypes of it, and we built them very early on just to test if people think this is interesting and to test what kinds of patterns we can actually put together. Right. So that's something you absolutely could have put together just on paper. The actual like type of the actual type of game makes a big difference about whether or not you'd actually do it. But yeah, it's meant to be one tool. It's one tool that you can use if it makes sense. If it doesn't make sense, don't use it. do you want to get stuck into a room? Maybe you can slap something together really quickly. I mean, you could just make a like tic-tac-toe or something. All right, I'll stick you in.
How does this work?
Okay, yeah.
All right. Oh, you have to do
that. Yeah, I'm going to stick you in a room right now, and then you should get a little prompt.
Okay.
You get a little prompt there?
All right, see you in a
bit. Perfect. See you in a bit. Yeah. Awesome. All right. I am going to run to the restroom real quick, and I'll be right back. All righty. I'm back. I'm going to go check in on each of the rooms, see how they're doing in there. Oh, we lost somebody. Well, well, well. How's it going in here, guys?
Horrible.
Doing fine. Oh, no. Why horrible?
No, we're good.
Okay, great. You guys working away?
Yep.
Yeah.
Any questions so far? Are you feeling good?
I'm just trying to sketch out and figure out, like, some semblance of the, I have no idea what the time scale is for what we're working on here. So
yeah, well, 3 minutes or less. Can you build this in 3 minutes or less? Can you play, play this in 3 minutes or less?
I definitely can't make this in 3 minutes. but yeah.
Awesome. All right. I'm going to be checking in on each of the rooms. Feel free to shoot me a DM if you have a question. Otherwise, you've got 15 more minutes.
Awesome.
All right.
Easy.
Well, well, well. Pleasure seeing you here. How's it going, guys? Thumbs up. Any questions so far?
Yeah.
Eduardo, you have such a friendly face.
Thank you. And yeah, I was thinking that if I can make the prototype on Photoshop, I can share my screen so both players can play at the same time.
Mm-hmm. That'd
be good.
Yeah, that sounds great.
Ah, perfect. I was doing that, so I didn't know if I could implement it that way.
Yeah, you'll be able to share your screens, and you will be playing with just one other person, but you could be their adversary. It's a great way to test.
Thank you, Roman.
Yeah. And Jordan, do you have a question?
I was just sort of, as I'm making my prototype, it already feels like it's not going to work.
Okay.
Which I know sort of is the point of making the prototype is figuring out if it works or not. But
yes.
So, but it's just sort of like, hmm. And then the question that I have from that is like, mm-hmm. how do you know if the idea doesn't work because some element of it needs to be tweaked or if it's just not a good idea at all?
Yeah. A lot of the question that you asked earlier too, like how do I even judge a timeline? A lot of these are just you'll get better at it as you make more games. So there's no, I can't really give you a technique. It feels to me like it's mostly obvious when something is a result of the game mechanics versus the medium that it's being presented in. Because if it's like, you know, this person is really bored and they are yawning or something, but it's taking you 60 seconds to orient everything in between each turn, then it might be a valid test to move it to digital to see if the computer can do that automatically and save the time so people aren't as bored. Mm-hmm. But if it's if there don't seem to be any significant setbacks as a result of it being on paper and they still are yawning, then that could be the concept. But either way, you're just going to get better at it as you do more of this kind of stuff. And playtesting, I'll say this in a second, I'll make this joke in a second, but playtesting really, if you do nothing else, playtesting really is the secret to excellent games, and you'll get better at playtesting as you playtest more. You'll sense stuff like that. Do you want to tell me the idea? Do you want to get some feedback on it?
Yeah, so I think me and Eduardo and Wayne talked about sort of an idea and sort of iterated on it a little bit, and basically the idea is an asymmetrical fighting game.
Okay.
And we sort of went through, did various iterations of it, but I'm starting from the beginning idea where you have somewhat, like you have your two characters are, one is a lover and one is a fighter. So like one person is like fighting with like they're apologizing for something they did wrong, or they, and the like then the opponent has like a heart meter that they're mm-hmm. they're being worn down that, and then the other character is like more of a typical like doing like physical attacks and like mm-hmm. physically wearing down the first character.
Yeah.
And sort of I think as I'm sort of trying, and I'm doing this like with a paper prototype with like cards.
Yep.
That have different attacks or not actually attacks on them. Mm-hmm. Attacks.
Yep.
But I'm sort of finding that as I'm writing these cards that it's like thematically I find that interesting, but the mechanic is sort of just it's still the just same fighting. Thing on both sides. It's still yeah. fighting. Yeah.
Yeah, I totally exactly. get that. I guess the first thing for me to say to that is that's probably how I would approach it too, or at least that would be my first approach. So I feel like you are on the right path. The second thing I'll say is don't underestimate thematics. I mean, I just gave you an example of where a person hit a button and the only reason it was funny is because of a single sentence, you are a kitten on a space station. Mm-hmm. Thematics make a big difference, even if the underlying mechanics mean nothing. So if the person plays a card and they say, I kiss you aggressively and you lose 3 HP, you know, that'll feel a lot different to that player than I'm drop kicking you and you lose 3 HP. Mm-hmm. So I think that for the sake of today, I would just do it how you can do it and then play test it how you can play test it. Mm-hmm. And you'll learn from there. You know, this doesn't really be a game that you ever work on again. Right. But for the future, I think playing with people is one of the only ways you can go about it. So sit down and go, all right, what's the first version I can put together that somebody can actually play, and then play that with somebody and then modify it in the future with better ideas.
Okay.
Yeah. Sound right?
Yeah.
Great. All right. By the way, have you seen Everything Everywhere All at Once?
Yes. I love that movie.
Oh my God.
It's so, so good.
Oh, it, I went as a, like somebody randomly suggested it and I knew basically nothing about it. And it, I was bawling my eyes out in the middle of the movie theater and then brought my parents later. So I'm mm-hmm. visiting them right now and they bawled their eyes out in the movie theater. So you're fighting with love. Made me think of that. Mm-hmm. So good.
Maybe that's where I subconsciously had that idea from.
Where it came from. That's great. Yeah. So
it's a great movie.
Don't underestimate theming. We had a lecturer come in from, I'm forgetting the name, the people who do all the famous story-based games, Telltale. We had somebody come in from Telltale in one of our past cohorts to talk about narrative design. And one of the parts of his talk that I thought was so simple and so powerful is how he does theming in his games. He'll like change a button. Instead of continue, it'll be like turn the page. And that mechanically makes literally no difference, but it makes mm-hmm. such a significant difference to how the player experiences it, which is all we're delivering as game designers. I mean, a card that does exactly the same thing, but where the title is I Hug You, is still a very different experience than a dropkick or whatever.
Cool.
Okay. There's the old saying, I think Will Wright is the one who said this. I think it was Will Wright. The old saying that as a game creator, as an engineer or a designer, you are programming for two different machines. You're programming the machine the game actually happens on, and you're programming the human brain, the player. So you are programming the brain differently by suggesting that they are hugging instead of punching.
Okay.
Yeah.
Cool. All right. I'll keep working on it.
Sounds great. I'm going to check on the last team. You have another 13 minutes-ish. I'm being very loose. We're doing good on time.
Okay.
All right. See you in a bit. Room number 4. Oh, God. Surya coming out of nowhere. How's it going in here, y'all?
I'm going to use my camera to test if this is
what's Oh, nice. That's great. How are the paper prototypes going? Do any of you have questions?
No, I'm good. I think I'm almost done with mine.
Okay. Are you, what are you working on, Enzo?
Yeah, so I think our group was really loving the idea of the timer as turns mm-hmm. and just kind of, you know, time being a main mechanic. So mm-hmm. my game is called 3 Minutes to Save the World, like the Madonna song, if anyone is old enough to remember that.
I don't know it, but I love it.
But the Madonna song is actually called 4 Minutes to Save the World. But
I see. That's great.
But basically, you get, like, you have turns and I put them in as 15 seconds, but whatever, like, that's the loop. And yep. Each loop has to make a decision on a key climate change issue.
Okay.
And yeah. And after, and because it's time, like, there's time pressure and there's lots of choices, I think there's a lot of replayability because it's a short game and people can go around and do it again. And at the end, you find out whether you did it or not.
Mm-hmm.
I wanted it to have a really low chance of success. So, you know, it's almost like the whole game is also one loop.
Mm-hmm. That's great. I love that. That's very, I'm intrigued by how that'll wind up playing out. I also like the altruistic intent behind the game concept. That's definitely something I care about. Okay. A+ to you. Kudos. Claps on that. Anybody feeling lost or confused or have questions? I'm just checking in.
I think I'm good. Should have something to show in a couple of minutes.
All right. So I'm going to give another 10 minutes and then we're going to come back together and start playing. Sound good?
Sounds good.
All right. If you guys all finish early, you can start going back and forth, maybe even play a little bit or just get ideas from each other. You'll be surprised how quickly you'll want to change stuff. For instance, my game, Quick Dungeon, is hot garbage. And I keep using it as an example because I don't want to make another game, but it's terrible. All right. See you guys soon.
Like terrible.
What's that?
Fun. It seemed fun enough. Why is it terrible?
It doesn't have enough depth and yet also takes too long. The whole promise was for it to be Quick Dungeon, but you saw, you know, we tested for 2 minutes and we did one room. But that's okay. You can disagree with me. You can take
Quick Dungeon. You just remove all the other rooms and you have a 2 minute prototype. So
yeah, exactly. Exactly. So these don't need to be good. These can be hot garbage and we will still clap for you. Successful prototyping. In fact, it's good if it's hot garbage. That's kind of the point, because now you know not to invest more time into it. All right. See you guys soon. Welcome back, intrepid game developers. Who has finished their paper prototype, or at least has a playable version? Jordan looks gung-ho, ready to go. Do we have, it just needs to be playable. Doesn't need to be perfect. Do we have playable paper prototypes? Hands raised. Ish. Okay. Well, here's what we'll do then. We're actually doing pretty well on time, which is great. We've got 40 minutes left. George says ish. Thanks, George. We're doing great on time. Got 40 minutes left. So why don't we do one play test live where you guys can see it actually happen. And then we'll split you into your rooms. So that'll give you a little bit of extra time if you're still struggling. And then that also means we can dissect how the person does and learn from it. Is anyone feeling brave who wants to play test their game live? All right, I saw Jim's hand first. Jim, you need one person to play, I'm assuming? All right, so I have a little bit of a talk on how to go about play testing. So I'm going to give you that information and then Jim is going to play and then we'll switch it into your rooms and you'll be able to play with your own people. So I was making this joke in one of the rooms. I make this joke all the time. My students make fun of me for it, but I mean it really, truly. You see those ads all the time that are like the one secret to never having to go to the doctor. Playtesting is the one secret to making incredible games.
Oh, I love the kitty, Eric.
Playtesting is the one secret to making incredible games. I really, really mean it. So playtesting simply means sitting down and playing your game with somebody in person. When I was at Lumosity, we would playtest three times a week. We would be playing our game with people three different times a week. And it can definitely become excessive. But at least at the beginning, when you are prototyping concepts and you're not sure about which concept to go with, so important to play with real people and to play with diverse people. Playtesting breaks you out of your biases. So you go, oh man, this game is so easy to understand and it's so much fun. And then you sit down and you play it with somebody and they're like, I don't know what's happening. And you will not, I guarantee you will not find that out without playing with somebody in person. The other thing is the people that you playtest with are the people that you make your game for. So if you're playtesting just by yourself and like with your mom, you're making a game for you and your mom. And that's okay if that's your intention. But if you're trying to make a game for a whole wide audience of people, playtest with a wide audience of people. So what makes a good playtest? A playtest, if you are unfamiliar, is literally just sitting down playing your game with somebody. Once again, it's founded from a single hypothesis or objective. So at the very beginning, obviously we're vetting ideas. We're trying to figure out which idea is best, but then even throughout the entire production process, we're still playtesting. And our objectives for the most part change over that time period. So when you are in the alpha phase where you're really just trying to make a vertical slice of your game, a lot of the time your playtesting objectives are, you know, is this jump mechanic that we added a valuable addition to the game? Once you get into beta, you're getting into more polish. So you're like, is this new menu layout good? It's the same thing that we were talking about for objectives. There's something that you're trying to test. You should have something you're trying to test every time you start a playtest, even if it's just, is this game fun? Finish by proving or disproving this theory, focus on player feedback, and walk away with action items, walk away with stuff you're going to change or test further. Before you actually start a playtest, create a prototype. Good job. You guys did it. Decide on a hypothesis or objective for this playtest. What are you actually trying to get out of this playtest? Decide on any questions that you need to answer, and then find somebody to actually play your game. While you are running the game, I recommend that you introduce the game, but you give just enough information to play. So you saw me do that with Quick Dungeon. I said, this is a dungeon crawling game. You can choose a class and you can move between rooms, and then I'll tell you what happens when you get to those rooms. The reason for this is basically to see what people do with little information. When playtesters ask you questions, I actually sometimes won't answer the questions just to see what happens, because that's valuable information. What do they do if they can't ask me questions? And then this is a very simple one, and I get so much value out of this. So write this one down, do this in the future. Ask them to think out loud before they start playing. So simple. Just say, hey, and while you play, do your best to tell me what you're thinking and feeling. And you'll get so much more information than if you didn't say that. Avoid distracting them. Don't ask questions. Don't point stuff out. Just let them play, watch them play, and continue on. Once you finish your playtest, this is like another funnel. Ask for their unguided opinion first. Ask the biggest, widest questions first. What did you think? And then get a little bit more specific. What did you think of the boss? What did you think of the first level? Then get a little bit more specific than that. What did you think of our jump mechanic? And then finish with the most specific questions. Did you find the menu confusing? And the reason you do it that way is to get as unbiased of a feedback as possible. With playtesting, your greatest enemy is that people tell you what they think you want to hear. They're trying to be nice. You know, that's humans. So they're going to be like, oh yeah, no, it wasn't confusing at all, if you ask them if something was confusing. But if you just say, what did you think? They'll probably go, oh, well, this was really confusing, because they'll be excited that they're helping you find something that can change about your game. So open-ended questions first, more specific later. And that's about it. I'm not going to bother doing a demo for you for the sake of time. You already saw me play games. You don't need to see me do more stuff. Why don't we have Jim here do a demo for us? Jim, would you like to play your game with someone?
I would love to play my game with someone.
All right. Who wants to play Jim's game?
It's a game where you play hungover carny, and it's called Milk the Rubes. So okay. Anybody who's into playing that, anybody?
I saw Corey and I saw Eduardo both raise their hands.
All right, we'll start with Corey. So Corey, if you could do me a favor and click on Google and type in roll a D20, and you'll get an automatic dice. A little hot tip
for you guys. That's great.
So when you have that on your screen, you're good?
Six.
Okay. I just want to make sure you're ready to go. Okay, so I'm going to start here by showing off this
space station.
Yeah, exactly. Space station. I have to turn off my
Zoom background. Yeah.
Let me see here. Ba-ba-bum. None. Okay, great. Okay, so this is going to be hard. So I'm not exactly sure. So I just have these three stickies. This is basically the midway milking funnel. I guess we'll start. Is this upside down? Am I seeing this upside down? Backwards?
No, that looks good. We can see it. We can see it correctly, yeah.
Okay, cool. So I think I'm going to have to zoom in on this so you can see these things. So it's 3 minutes till the midway opens. You have exactly 3 minutes, and that amounts to having three tokens, three Carney tokens, 1 minute apiece. So what you have to decide in your hungover state is if you want to spend it partying with the townies and hopefully attract more people to the midway, building slash fixing your midway rides, so your roller coasters and whatnot, or spending time rigging your games of chance. So you have three tokens to put in any order or in any a number into those three different activities. Again, you only have 3 minutes, so you have to, I mean, not literally, but like in this context. So, Corey, where do you think you'd like to put your time?
I'm a carny. I'm gonna spend all three coins in like rigging the games.
Rigging the games. Okay, excellent.
An economist.
Yeah. Okay. So we're doing that. So
statistically, that's got to work out for me, right?
We'll see.
House
we'll
always see. Wins.
If the ride breaks down, who cares?
This is yes. Oh, I should have mentioned. As you can see at the bottom there, there's a 50% chance of death, a baseline.
My personal death?
No. Of the rubes of of the people that come through the door. So we're going to start with your.
We have shovels and tents. Nobody's going to see a thing would happen.
We're going to see how this plays out. So you decided not to party with the locals at all. That means you end up with a base of 10 people that come through the door, right? So we're going each minute that you spend partying, you get an extra a d20 in addition to that. So you could have rolled say you rolled a d20 and you got a 20, then you would have had 30 people come through the midway entrance. So at the moment you have 10. So you have 10 comes through. Now because as I say, 50% chance of death on your roller coaster. Five of them die. Yeah. Oh, so sadly, there we go. So we've got five people. Now, you spent all your time on rigging the games of chance, which is great. It means that you get to roll a D4. So could you roll a D4 for me? Tell me what you get.
Yes, I got a 4.
Oh, well, there you go. That's pretty good. So that means your base of $2 gets added to by 4. So you get actually six per rube. So and there's 5 rubes, I believe, right? That's where we ended up. So you get
$30.
What's that?
5 times 4.
5 times 4.
Five times 6. Excuse me. $30.
$30. So yeah. So you end with a score of $30.
At the cost of only 5 lives.
Hey, you know, it's that happens. It happens. So. I don't know if anybody else wants to play real quick or if we should move on, but
I think it's good for us to stop so you can play this in person, but that was that's excellent. Claps all around for that. Thank you for being brave and thank you for playing.
No, thank you.
That's like it's an interesting like statistical analysis game. something that I was talking to Jordan about, just to point things out, there is no reason that game needs to be about carnivals. Mm-hmm. That's the theme of the game. The actual gameplay had nothing to do with carnivals at all. We could have put on so many different themes, but it meant something, and it allows us to imagine the game and feel the game in a different way because people are dying on carnival rides, right? Mm-hmm. So your theme of the game really makes a huge difference in addition to the actual gameplay. That was great.
Thanks.
All right. So that's what you're actually doing with people. We are, I'm going to stick you in random pairs. How many people do we have left in here? 12 people, including me. That means I get to play games. So we're going to do random pairs. We're going to give you 15 or so minutes for you to play your game. Each person should play the other person's game. So I'll shoot you a message when it's time to switch off. If we have enough time, maybe we'll do a second round. If not, we'll come back together and talk about it. Maybe play some games with the group. All right. Does everybody have a game that they can play with the other people?
Hanesh, did you manage to finish something? Oh, you're currently muted.
I have something. Okay. I don't know. It's a game I can play with somebody else, like a single player concept.
It'll be. Will it work? Ish.
Ish. I can explain.
Right. Okay. Good. That's good enough. So I will let Zoom assign us automatically in pairs. Give me a second. Jordan is by himself. Okay, so George, Wayne, and Anzal, you all have games that you can play as well?
Yeah.
Yeah, I do.
Fantastic, awesome. All right, so I'm gonna open the rooms. Jordan, you and I are gonna be hanging out together, so we get to play, I get to play your game. And then I'm gonna pop around through the rooms after a couple minutes to see where everyone's at. Like I said, if we cruise through it, we're all feeling good, we could do a second round of this. Otherwise, we'll just get one round in. All right, rooms are open. You're playing both persons' games. What's up, Jordan?
Hello, how are you?
Good, how you doing?
Okay. You were asking me earlier if I had like finished the game, and basically there was just like an extra thing I was trying to do at the last minute, and I didn't.
Yeah.
So
okay,
not actually that important.
It's good enough.
Yeah. Okay. The question is how.
Do you have your name on your own shirt there in code?
Okay. So this is from my coding boot camp. Like we have like a class shirt. This is just my class shirt.
Nice.
It's basically just like. An array with all of our names in it, and it like it's in Ruby, and it like spits out each name is a developer.
That's awesome.
Because they tried to like make us like not say like I'm an aspiring developer. Like you learn how to code, you're a developer. And
yes,
that was sort of the idea.
That's so funny. That's one of the things we do in the first day at our bootcamp. Dinesh is asking for help. Let me just go make sure he's all right, and I'll come right back. Okay.
Okay.
All right.
Hey, can't do screen sharing.
Ah, shit. One second. I'll be right back.
Excellent. Boom, there we go. All right, so here's my very, very simple game. You guys hear me?
Yeah.
All right, so the idea is that you are going to build it.
You good? Okay, so let me try to figure out how to position my computer so this will work. And then also, okay. Do-do-do-do-do-do.
Amazing.
This is I need to put it on top of like something taller.
Sure.
I didn't think about this part.
Yeah, this part's a little challenging sometimes.
Okay, here's a box behind me.
Okay.
You get to see how like absolutely like this is my like arts and crafts slash office room. So it's kind of messy.
No problem.
Okay, can you see this kind of okay?
Yes, indeed.
Okay. So I can't draw, so don't laugh at my drawings, but
that sounds like a fixed mindset.
That I can't draw?
Yes.
well, I can't.
It's fine. You look great. Let's go. They look okay. Great.
Okay. So this is called Lovers and Fighters. This okay. is an asymmetrical. I've explained this a little to you already, but
yeah.
But just again that this is a asymmetrical fighting game where one person is a lover and one person is a fighter. Okay. So the first thing we have to do for this game is to decide on the topic of the dispute. And okay. we can do that by rolling a dice.
Okay.
Well, actually, let me first ask, would you like to play as the lover or the fighter?
Lover.
Okay, you're the lover.
Kindness.
So you as the lover are a lover, but you've also made some missteps and you have angered your partner.
Oh no.
So we're going to roll a dice to see what the reason for the dispute is.
Okay.
And then I've written down a couple of them. Some of them we might have to just make it up on the spot, but.
So this is the, number one.
Okay, I rolled a one. So the reason for the dispute is you forgot my birthday.
Ah, shit, I'm so sorry.
That's okay. So we each have, so we're going to have a asymmetrical sort of weird fight here, and we each have 5 health, but okay. I have 5 swords, so like actual, or you have 5 swords, so like actual physical damage, and I have 5 hearts, which are the like the emotional damage.
Is this the prequel to the Amber Heard Johnny Depp trial?
Oh dear. Okay, so I'm going to show, so you are the lover. I'm going to show you, we're going to eat just for this play test, because I can't reach through the screen and give you these cards. We'll have open hands.
Okay.
And there's also only 5 cards so far.
Okay.
So you have, your cards are smooches. I lose 2 hearts.
All right.
Apologize. I lose 1 heart.
Okay.
Bouquet of flowers. I lose my next turn.
Okay.
Memory lane. This one is a little different. If a dice roll is greater than 4, I lose 1 heart.
Okay.
Else, if it's less than 4, or if it's 4, wait, no. If it's 4 or less, you take 1 damage.
Okay.
And then mindfulness and meditation is the last card, and you heal 1 like of your damage.
Okay.
So just if you need me to remind you of what any of those cards are, just let me know so that I can read them to you again.
Okay.
Okay, so as the lover, you go first, and we've determined that the dispute is because you forgot my birthday. So as you were playing these cards, also we're sort of like role-playing that you forgot my birthday.
Okay. All right, I am so sorry that I forgot your birthday. The first thing I want to do, of course, is apologize.
Okay. So you have played the apology card. I lose 1 heart. I'm going to just discard it over there. And I lose a token.
Okay. Okay.
Also, we're like dinosaurs for some reason. I don't know why I made that decision. But
there's that old, there was a dating game a long time ago. Love Tyranno or something, where you date a Tyrannosaurus Rex.
Interesting. There's a lot of, yeah. And then there's the pigeon one anyway.
Yeah, there's a lot of those.
Yeah. Okay, so I'm going to not accept your apology. I'm still super mad at you, and I'm going to stab you, and you take 1 damage.
Shit. All right. So I have 4 cards left then? Is that what
you
that
have
means?
4 cards left, yeah.
Okay. I'm going to go for big damage then. Bringing out the big guns if the apology isn't working. I'm going in for smooches.
All right. I take 2 damage. I don't know what you even call that.
your heart is softening.
Mm-hmm. My heart of ice is like slowly melting.
Right.
And so you've lost. So you discard the smooches card.
Mm-hmm.
And now I'm going to try some chance, and I'm going to do, I didn't tell you what my cards are. I probably should have also, oh, I'll just play them, but I'm going to play fake apology.
Oh no, you always do this.
Roll a dice. If 4 or higher, you cause 1 damage, else lose 1 heart.
Okay.
So I'm going to roll a dice, see what it is. Oh, I rolled a 1. I lost a heart. I'm losing. I am not winning this game.
It was a real apology by accident.
I think that means it just didn't work. But yeah. Okay. So now it's your turn. What do you want to do?
I have 1 that heals 1. I have the random chance 1. And then what was the 3rd one?
Bouquet of flowers that I skip my next turn.
Okay. I'm gonna go for the random chance then. What's that one called?
Memory lane. So memory you're distracting lane. Me with old memories.
Don't you remember when you stabbed me last time and I only came back stronger?
Okay. And this is another, like, if greater than four.
Yep.
So.
Yes! Oh,
that is six. All right.
Dominated.
I lose one heart. I am softened.
Okay.
So you have won this game.
Yes. Amazing.
Excellent. Okay.
Okay. Cool. I have some feedback. I'm going to come back in just a second, though, because Jim has asked for help. So let me bring my back, Jordan. Thank you.
Thanks. I'm going to
room three.
Focus back on my.
What's up, Jim?
Oh, hey. Oh. Hey, great. We can't share screens.
Oh, that should have already been enabled.
Oh, now it's enabled.
Oh, okay, great.
Okay.
I had someone else ask about the same problem, so probably we fixed it after you noticed it.
Okay, cool. No problem.
No problem.
Awesome.
All right.
Alrighty.
Okay. I'm back.
Cool.
All right. So that was a lot of fun. That was pretty hysterical.
Awesome.
Do you want feedback?
Absolutely.
All right. So my greatest piece of feedback as a game designer, I was expecting there to be something other than health in play.
Okay.
Because there are very different kinds of games out there. Have you played Munchkin?
Yeah.
Yeah. So Munchkin, very low player autonomy. You know, basically you just fight.
My husband hates that game.
Yeah. Yeah.
for that reason, probably. It's just not.
Right.
You can't do a lot.
It's just random chance.
Exactly.
So there are games like that, is what I'm saying. But for the most part, one of the core promises that we make as game designers is autonomy. We're saying you get the choice to do blah. So what I was sort of expecting to hear out of this was some alternative to health, some reason to not just always pick the thing that does the most damage, because that's what I wound up doing. Mm-hmm. I was just going, okay, well, that's the most damage, followed by that. And I did the apology first because I thought it was funny. But for the most part, that means that my player autonomy is pretty low. I have a preset formula that it doesn't make sense to deviate from. And so that's all I'm going to do.
Okay.
So I might try to brainstorm some way, like Slay the Spire is my go-to deck combat game as an example. Have you played Slay the Spire?
I've not played it. I do know of it, though.
Yeah. So the simple way that they go, they have a ridiculous amount of depth to their game, but one very simple element that they have is block. So I can either deal damage or I can block, and block stays around for only that turn. So there's some strategy to like trying to figure out when I should block because I think the enemy is going to be dropping a big damage attack. But that means I'm not going to be dealing damage, so it might not be good to block right now. So like if I knew what cards you had, and therefore I knew what cards were left, if I'm paying attention to you, then maybe I'm going to be like, okay, I know she still has the two damage attack, so I'll drop some block right now to try to protect myself or whatever. Mm-hmm. Regardless, it just, even if that wasn't the solution, I think a greater degree of depth of play is something that I was feeling a desire for, you know?
Okay.
Yeah. But otherwise, I think it was cute and funny. it's definitely, it makes me think of like spousal abuse, which seems bad, but maybe you can sort of play off of that. Like maybe it's sort of part of the purpose of the game is to suggest why that is bad or something.
That's a good point. I was sort of like hoping that sort of the idea of like one person is sort of like trying to make it up to the other person is like a subversion of like just a fighting game trope generally, but that is a good point. It's like, is this sort of like two people who are using each other? And
yeah, I could see it being more like, because you have literally like stab as one of the moves, I could see it being more about like a violent or maybe not even violent, like aggressive tendency, like shout or something like that. But have the end result be showing that that's a bad thing or something, have the game mechanics actually demonstrate that shouting is worse than apologizing or something. But that's also, you know, that's more about conscious gaming, which is not necessarily always the objective. Okay. Or you could just make it not be, because it felt like, you know, it was supposed to be that I was fighting with my partner. You could also just maybe remove that theming and make it more about like you're a superhero who loves stuff, even though it tries to kill you. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay.
But that was great. I think that you put something together that was totally playable and kind of interesting. It's got some flair and I feel like a direction going on. Kind of reminded me of Undertale maybe, since in Undertale you have such a the ability to decide not to fight stuff. You can do a pacifist run. Right. There's always an option besides fighting. You should be proud of yourself. Well done.
Thank you. Yeah. I appreciate it. I don't have like, I'm mostly a programmer. I don't have a lot of design background. So I was really drawn to this workshop because I was like, I want to try to get more knowledge about that. So
yeah. Yeah, design is really interesting. It's sort of, I started as an engineer and I transitioned into solid design. Now I am a game designer. And I still do engineering as a part of my job, but only prototype code, which is great because that's the only part that I like. I hate trying to make things efficient and robust and bug free. But I definitely, it's a pretty significantly different mindset, but I also think that you can apply some of your coding mentality, your engineer's mentality to design. And it kind of winds up giving you unique concepts. Because typically a game designer is coming from a soft skills category. They're coming in with design chops. They're coming in with like, I'm going to be more emotional, have some more UX experience. I'm going to talk about the feelings of the player and the, the different dreams this player has and the fantasies the player is trying to fulfill, versus an engineer is coming in with hard skills. They're saying, this is how this works. This is how we fix bugs. So as an engineer, you can approach design, I think, in a very different way from most people.
Cool. Okay.
Yeah. I think a good game designer is something like an economist. You're really like breaking down the key pieces of what makes a game and figuring out how to balance them, etc. Yeah.
Awesome.
Yeah.
And so also to bring up the Calendly link. So you're just having sort of like office hours kind of stuff.
Yeah. So I'm going to mention it in a second. Part of the reason to do this workshop is to get our name out there, but we have a cohort coming up for our next program, IGA level 3, which I'll basically, imagine three months of Hogwarts, 3 months of what we just did, primarily game design and game production. You join a team, come up with an original concept with that team, publish that game to a store of your choice by the end of that 3 months under the guidance of 7 industry professionals. So a bunch of teachers from the industry. Myself as the main teacher, and then we got a couple cool names coming up. So the 30 minutes is meant to be a career consultation, whatever the heck you need. If you're trying to figure out how to break into the space or what to do for your next game, we can talk about that. But then if you wanted to talk about our cohort, it's a chance to do that too.
Okay.
Yeah. So yeah, very much recommend. I'd love to, have a one-on-one chat sometime, Jordan. That'd be great.
I agree. That would be great for me.
Awesome. I will drop the link one more time, and it's actually time to close the rooms. So I'm going to head back out to the main session.
All right. Thanks, Will.
Of course. Ooh. We're almost there. And then I have another meeting after this, and then another meeting after that, and then I'm finally done for the week. Too many meetings. Oh,
hello. Fancy, I was just here. I was just by myself, so I was like, I should probably just come back.
Might as well just come back. Yeah, we've got. Let's see. Where's the breakout room buttons? Another 10 seconds before they come back anyway. Here they come. Welcome back, everybody. I'm seeing some smiles. Did we have a good time? Did we play amazing games together? Awesome. Fantastic. Did everybody get a chance to play their game, test their game? Great. Okay. So hopefully you have, where is my presentation go? Oh, it got stuck over on my other desktop. One second. So hopefully you came away with a sense of how to create a paper prototype and actually do a play test. We covered a lot of different stuff today. The main thing is we talked about basically why we prototype in the first place, what the prototyping process is all about. We covered what a concept funnel is. We covered what filter listing is. And then of course we covered what paper prototyping is and how to play test with a paper prototype. I'd love to hear, just because it's good to, this is a very simple learning technique. When you regurgitate the stuff that you learn it even more deeply. So I would love to hear some of the stuff that you guys are gonna be walking away from today with, whether it's an actual lesson you learned or maybe it's something you realized about your game. I'd love to just hear some, you know, some feedback, some stuff. Tell me things.
I got a simple, easy one.
Okay.
I hate all of my concepts.
Yes, that's a success. Now you cross out all those ideas and you start again.
I did not spend a bunch of time developing this.
Perfect. Nailed it. Amazing. Anything else?
I'd say more or less the same. While there were good things about my prototype, there were also bad things about it. And
yeah,
it was not perfect and it wasn't complete.
Yep.
And that was good. That was good.
Yeah. That's totally normal. That's great too. So yours, maybe it sounds like it might be worth investigating more deeply. Is that right?
Yeah, it might.
Yeah.
Yeah. Like another round of cleaning it up. It might be more functional.
Maybe. That's great though. Yeah. A mentality that I try to instill in my students and that I just recommend for anybody who's in the game industry. You're not trying, you shouldn't be trying to make your idea the perfect game. What you should be trying to do is to discover the perfect game. You are, don't be tied to any particular idea, be tied to making a good game, because then you're going to be more open to completely you know, wiping out an idea that you thought was going to be good or pivoting really heavily. Has anyone ever, this is sort of random, has anyone ever carved stone, done rock carving? I've done it at least a little bit. And there's this saying among rock carvers that the stone already knows what it wants to be before you begin, that you sort of discover, you know, what this thing should be. And I find the same thing with games. You'll think that you have a great concept and it winds up being, you know, sort of like that, but completely different as a result of playtesting with people. And that's a big part of what I hope you walk away with this with.
Well, during my playtester, Surya said, I'm gonna move the player up to block the line of sight. And then I responded with saying, oh, I didn't think about that. And then it's like, so let's pretend that's true. And
yeah,
now I got to figure out what the heck the AI is supposed to do.
Yeah.
Since that was a pretty good idea, actually.
That's a great idea. And that's a great little point. You'll often discover stuff like that. You'll often discover what's fun about a game as a result of somebody playing. And you'll sometimes discover things that, like you'll find bugs that wind up being way more fun than anything else, that wind up being a core part of the game. A common value, I guess, of paper prototyping is actually figuring out the stuff that you know is going to be broken or a sticking point later so that you don't ever have to build it. All right, so anybody have any last questions before I close this down for the day?
Thanks very much for putting this on. It was really, really helpful to have that sort of time boxed kind of requirement to finish a paper prototype. I think that's the first one I've
definitely
ever done.
Yeah. Awesome. I'm so glad. Thank you, Tim. Yeah, I really love, this is such a simple exercise and I really love it. And it's also just fun. My partner and I have been doing all kinds of travels around the world and we were down in Mexico. I'm a huge Warhammer 40K fan. If anyone here is a Warhammer 40K fan. I didn't have my figures with me. And so one of the things I did was invent a whole game that I could play with myself that was basically Warhammer 40K, you know, and I just did it on paper. There was no need for it to go anywhere except on my own desk. And, you know, that's what this is for. It's for us as game designers to explore, to have fun, and just to play. That's what we do. So part of the reason that I do this is to bring in new members into our community. So now that I know you guys are amazing people, as I sent earlier, if anyone missed it, you are more than welcome to come and join our Discord. We are, we specifically focus on trying to help people break into the industry. and people who are trying to start their own studios. So if you want to find a community of people who are just breaking in, who are just understanding how the industry works, and who want to see the industry be a better place and more comprehensive, more enlightened community, then we're your people. We think we're Jedis or something. We think we're saving the world with games. So I would love to have you all there. I also offer free 30-minute calls if you want to talk about how to break into the industry. As I also mentioned earlier, I am available. You can use this link here. And the last thing, the last reason to put these together is because we have our next level 3 cohort coming up June 6th. So the Indie Game Academy helps people break into the industry. And the primary way we do that is through our 3 programs. Our main one, our big kahuna, our bread and butter is IGA level 3. Basically, imagine online Hogwarts. We take students, we sort them into a mock indie studio. We literally have a sorting ceremony on day one. Those studios then work with each other over the course of 3 months to come up with a completely original brand new game concept, and then publish that concept to a store of your choice, typically mobile, but we allow you to do whatever you want. You do so under the guidance of 7 industry professionals from some of the big names out there. So in this next cohort, I am super pleased to say that we have Victor Blanc, who is an art director at Mojang, one of the art directors on Minecraft, who's going to be coming in to talk about how to theme your game and more. We have Tony Sharma, who's a game designer at Wizards of the Coast, working on Magic the Gathering and Dungeons and Dragons and all kinds of other cool stuff like that. So we're trying to get you exposure. It's like a mini GDC, and we're trying to get you a lot of understanding of how to actually put a game together so that you can intelligently sit down in a job interview to break into the space and talk about your process building games with us. So if a gamified, ridiculous bootcamp, if this times 24 with a team sounds exciting to you, schedule a call. I'd love to chat. No obligation. If we wind up talking about something else instead, that's great too. I just love talking one-on-one. So that's my spiel. I think we've reached the end of our time. Y'all are awesome. Thank you for your time. This has been a lot of fun. Great way to close down my week. I hope everyone has a kick butt day.
Thank you so much, Roland. It's a great class.
Of course.
Yeah. Enjoyed everybody, Sean. Thank you so much.
Take care to Thank everybody.
You. It was a lot of fun. Thank you.
Definitely. Thank you. Thank you.
I'll hit you up, Willem.
Let's do it. Yeah. Join the Discord. Schedule a call. Chat again sometime soon. All right. Peace, everybody. Take care. Have a wonderful weekend.
Bye. Bye-bye. Bye.